Hi everyone, sorry for the delay. It is my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Tom Zimmerman as our next speaker for the IELTS Distinguished Speaker Series. So here I just want to bring a very brief bio for Dr. Zimmerman. He is a senior researcher in the Research and Engineering Group at Microsoft Research in Redmond, USA. His research interests including software productivity, data science, recommender systems, and game research. He's best known for his research work on systematic mining of software repository to conduct empirical studies and to build tools to support developers and managers. He is currently the chair of ACM SIGSOFT. He is also the general chair for ASC 2019 and program chair for FSC 2020. He is the co-editor, co-editor-in-chief of the Empirical Software Engineering Journal, and serves on the editorial boards of various journals, including IEEE Transactions on Software Engineering. He received his PhD in 2008 from Saarland University in Germany. So without any further delay, let's welcome Dr. Zimmerman.
So thank you very much for the invitation. Can everyone hear me fine? In feedback, you can hear me? Perfect. So I'm going to try without microphone. Today I want to talk to you about two things I've been working on over the past 3 years, and it's basically about data science and productivity. And so, but before I talk about this, I briefly want to give like a shout out to our research group and at Microsoft Research. So here you see one of our group pictures. That's the Empirical Software Engineering Group. So it's a subgroup of a research and software engineering group at Microsoft Research in Redmond. And it's 3 to 4 core researchers. And then every year in summer, we get many interns and visiting researchers. And these are the ones you see on the slide. So what's really nice about doing research at Microsoft is that it's a unique position to do research, because we actually have very easy access to industrial problems. So Microsoft is a large software company which has built very complex software, and they run into many problems and want to find solutions to build software more efficiently. We also have very easy access to software engineers, and that's something you're going to see in the rest of the talk, that a lot of the work I do is actually not just on software itself, it's together with the software engineers to understand how we work and what challenges we face. It's easier to have near-term impact if you're within a company, and also Microsoft Research is a great place for collaborations with other Microsoft researchers, because you have really strong groups in HCI, databases, systems, AI, and it's also great to do external collaborations. So over the past, we have done work with many different product groups in the Empirical Software Engineering Group, like Windows, Office, Bing, Visual Studio, and Xbox, and many others. Okay, so here you see some of the questions we worked on. So you see it's a very wide set of research that we've looked into. And it's all basically about how we can make software development more efficient by using data to make informed decisions. So you see we've done work on testing, on defect prediction, and also distributed software development. So I mentioned today I'm going to talk about data science and productivity, and I want to start off with like a brief overview of data science. So who has heard of data science? Okay, who thinks we know everything about data science? Okay. So let me start off with data science. And that's, it's kind of interesting because I've been, like my entire research career, I've been sort of in a data science role, because I always analyzed some software engineering data for empirical studies or to build some like recommendation models. So here's like a textbook definition of what analytics is. And that's basically the use of data analysis and systematic reasoning to inform and to make decisions. So what you see with this definition, like the decision making is really emphasized, and data science is very close. It's a little bit has more, it also is very important to support decisions, but it also can have sometimes more of a focus on informing decisions down the road. So there have been many cases of analytics actually in software over the past decades. It goes back to the early days of the internet, when you had like web analytics systems which were just counting how many page visits you have had, down to like fully developed dashboards now, like Google Analytics, where you can really figure out like how people came to your website, what paths they took through your website, and things like that. So the other place where analytics has been fairly big is actually video games. And part of the reason is that in video games, what happens is data collection is part of the user experience. So if you have like a car racing game and you have a certain track, you want to know who's the fastest person worldwide on this track. And for this to surface to the user, to the player, you actually need to collect this information, store and display at some point. And that also allows you to do some additional data analysis. And so there's been some work on Halo to find out like where are the difficult spots in Halo levels. And also like free to play was very data driven. So some people even joked that the games are half built, then just deployed so that the game developers can figure out what features to build next to maximize money. And the other thing is usage analytics. And here's one example which was done at Microsoft like quite a while ago, actually. But it's basically, there used to be an old version of the File Explorer in Windows 7. And for Windows 8, what we decided is to basically redesign the File Explorer to make it more user-friendly. And what we used to during this process is basically we did a lot of data analysis, like what commands people were using in the old File Explorer, and if it can increase the way that these commands can be reached. So what happened is that in the old File Explorer, it was very difficult to get to commands like copy and paste. And now copy and paste, you can see it's like one of the more prominent buttons in the File Explorer. So I showed you like a diverse set of analytics approaches. And that's something which Dongmei Shang from the Microsoft Research Asia group, I think, characterized really well. So she called it the Trinity of Software Analytics, which is basically you have, when you do analytics or data science, there are like three parts of your software that you can think about. So one is the software system itself, like for example, Windows. Then you can think about the software development process, like how you're building Windows, like what changes you make, how fast you fix bugs. But you have also to think about the software user, like how are people actually using your software? How are they interacting with Windows? And then you have like a different set of technology pillars which you can use for software analytics. There's been a long history of software analytics. It goes back to the 70s, where some people built first defect models to basically characterize which parts of a software are more likely to be prone to defects. And there have been several special issues on software analytics, books on analyzing software data, and data science for software engineering. So that's the end of the self-promotion. What I want to talk to you about now is basically people. So, and specifically the people who are doing data science. Because so what one thing which happened over the past few years is that data scientists became like a very popular job role. So some people said data scientist is the sexiest job of the 21st century. At Microsoft, our CEO, Satya Nadella, he wrote a famous memo inside the company where he said that we need to modernize our engineering practices and processes to be customer-obsessed, data-driven, speed-oriented, and quality-focused. And his idea to achieve this was basically to have data and applied sciences resources for each engineering group. So these are basically data scientists who work with the software engineers to make the software more efficient and more accessible and usable to our customers. So basically, everyone was looking for data scientists and trying to actually understand what a data scientist does. And so there's been some work when I did with Myung Kim, Rob DeLine, and Andrew Bagel, where we basically tried to understand and characterize how data scientists work at Microsoft. And so we used different methodologies. So we did interviews because initially it was fairly difficult to identify data scientists because it was like a very new role. So we did interviews with 16 data scientists, which we identified through snowball sampling. So basically we had a few people to start with, and then we asked each data scientist, hey, we want to interview more data scientists. Who do you think is like a good choice at Microsoft to interview? We did some coding and some clustering of responses. We also did a survey, like once Satya Nadella basically told the company to hire data scientists, what happened over the next year or so is that many data scientists were hired, and also we got our own job discipline for data scientists. So 1 year after we did the interviews, it was actually fairly easy to identify the population of people at Microsoft who work on data science. So what we did is we ran a large survey for which we got about 800 responses, and we asked various things like demographics, skills, how they work, how they spend time. So let me show you some of the results. So first, a little bit about the background, and this comes from interviews and the survey. So what we found is that most data scientists actually have they mostly have a CS background. A lot of them have interdisciplinary backgrounds. Many actually had higher education degrees. So around 41% had a master's degree and 22% had a PhD when we did the survey. They typically usually show like a strong passion for analyzing data. So like how this participant said is, I've been always a data kind of guy. I love playing with data. We also found that a lot of them are sort of like machine learning hackers. They know the stats, they know enough about how to program to be dangerous. So that's really important to have some statistics background. And also it's important to have statistics background and being able to explain statistics to people who don't have a statistics background. Okay. And what we found is also in the interviews is that the PhD training contributes strongly to the working style of data scientists, because doing data science projects in companies, it's often very similar to doing a PhD or a research project at a university. So first you have to figure out how to do experiments. You have to figure out what are actually relevant research questions to look at, or what are relevant questions for a company to look at. And sometimes you end up in dead ends, and sometimes you have to go back and re-investigate our directions. So here's how a typical data science workflow looks like. And this is actually based on a blog post that one of my former interns, Philip Guo, wrote for the Communications of ACM blog. And what you can see is usually you start off with some preparation phase where you get the data, do some data cleaning. Then you have this analysis phase, which is followed by some reflection. And usually you go back then to the analysis phase. Some cases you might go back to preparation, but what eventually comes is dissemination. So you also need to show your results to other people so that they're useful. And so for the survey, we used sort of this data science workflow, like a slight variation, to find out how people spend the time. And so here you can see how data scientists spend time. So you see, it's basically a box plot. It shows you like a box which basically corresponds where the majority of people spends. Where around 50% of people spend the time. And then it also shows you, like the lines show you where like 100%, roughly 100% of people spend the time, like if you take the left point of a line to the right point of a line. And then you have these small circles, which are sort of considered outliers, which are much higher than what than the other people who responded. So what you can see is like a lot of people spend, like a lot of time is spent on querying existing data, preparing data, analyzing data. But it's really this data scientists spend a lot of time in all activities. And I actually have a more easier visualization in a second. So actually what we ended up doing is we took this data, like how people spend time on data science activities, and we did some clustering to identify specific types of data scientists. And so this is what you can see on this slide. So the top row shows you how much percent and how many hours data scientists typically spend in each activity. So for the entire population, 12% of the time, which corresponds to roughly 4.7 hours, would be spent on querying existing data. What we found through the cluster analysis is that for different clusters, like cluster one, it's basically equally spread out through all the data science activities. And so we call this cluster the polymath, because data scientists who are polymaths, they basically do the entire thing from acquiring data, analyzing data, to reflecting and to disseminating data. So what you can also see is there are certain specialist roles. So if you look at cluster two, cluster two spends a lot of the time in engaging with others about data science. And they also spend a significant time of for work on disseminating insight. So we called this cluster for data evangelist. We found specialist roles for data preparation and also for data shaping, which is basically transforming the data in a form which is more suitable for analysis. We found specialists for analyzing data, for platform builders. So platform builders are basically the people who build like a data analysis framework or data collection framework that other people can use for their work. Another thing we found was so-called moonlighter clusters, which basically are people who do data science work, but only part-time. Like not the entire time while they're working for Microsoft, but only 50% or only 20% of the time is spent on data science activities. So just one slide to summarize it. So basically we have these generalist roles, we have specialists. Usually what we find is that specialists are more common in larger teams, because for larger teams it makes more sense to have people who are specialized on one activity, while smaller teams, they need to have one person. Like if you can have only one data scientist on your team, you want to have someone who can do most of the activities. We also found manager roles and the moonlighter roles. Another project I did related to data science is, and that's together with Andy Bagel, was to find out what are the things that data scientists actually should work on in a company. And so this is inspired by Craig Wilson, who used to be at Mozilla. He is not at Mozilla anymore. But he, when he was at Mozilla, he basically was giving a keynote at a workshop on the future of mining software repositories in Kingston, so not far away from here. Where he basically, in his keynote, to prepare for his keynote, he went to a senior developer at Mozilla and told him, hey, I'm going to meet people who really know how to analyze data. What would you like to know from these people? And so basically this experienced developer came up with a list of 10 questions. So here you see some, like which IDEs are more useful. But basically, Andy and I thought that's like a really smart idea. At Microsoft, we have lots of experienced developers what if we ask the same question to Microsoft developers? And so that's what we did. The result is a catalog of 145 questions. And I'm briefly going to show you how we compiled this catalog and what are the most important questions. So the first step was we did a survey. So basically, we did the same style that Craig Wilson did, is we sent out a survey to Microsoft developers. We got back 203 responses, and the 203 responses gave us around 700 questions that we could work with. Then we did some card sorting exercises to group the questions into categories. And once we had the categories, we distilled the questions into a set of representative questions that describe basically the category, and that was how we ended up with the 145 questions. We did a second survey where we basically asked about how important people feel that these questions are. And this is where we got 600 participants, and they rated a total of 16,000, who provided 16,000 ratings. So this is the top 10. So this is what Microsoft developers really would like to know with data. So number one is, how do users typically use my application? Number two is, what parts of software product are most used and or loved by customers? If you go down to the top 10 to number 9 and 10, you see what are common patterns of execution in my application. So that's very related to the previous two questions. It's just from a different perspective, from the perspective of someone who tests the application or who writes the application, and also how well does test coverage correspond to actual code usage by our customers. So how well do we test the software? Does it actually match with how customers are using the software? And this goes back to the trinity of software analytics that I showed you in the beginning. When you think of analytics, it's like knowing more about your customer, your user, is really important. And this, I think, underlines this. There was also, and because I'm going to come back to productivity, like one of the top 10 questions was also about, what is the impact of specific tools on productivity? So for example, recently Microsoft got a new code review tool. So people were really interested, oh, does code review, or how does this specific tool affect my productivity? We have a list of unwise questions. So these are things where people are are more concerned about the use of data to address these questions. And a lot of them basically come down to using data to automatically assess the performance of developers. So what developers do not want is data scientists to build like models that allow a manager to automatically assess who should get a good performance review and who should get a bad performance review. And interestingly, this was more concerned by individual contributors. So managers were not so much concerned about this, because in reality, metrics like this are not used for performance review at Microsoft. It's a much more, like, performance review at Microsoft has a very strong qualitative component. With that said, I want to talk about productivity and show you some of the work I've been working on. And so there's one thing I want you to take away from the talk. And so if you think about the stereotypical software developer, so how does the stereotypical software developer look like? Any guesses? No guess? Okay. A lot of people, when they hear software developer, they think of someone sitting in a basement, in a garage, in front of a... it's close enough, right? Someone sitting in a basement, bad posture, like in this case, smoking cigarettes, like unhealthy lifestyle, drinking lots of Coke, sitting the entire day in front of a computer, having classes, and yeah. So that's obviously not how software development looks like. And so that's the thing I want to take you away. It's actually software development is much, much more than sitting in front of a computer. And actually, when we did some studies, we found that developers spend as much time away from the computer than they spend in front of it.
Okay, and I actually want to see that instead of the picture. I want to show you
a visualization of a workday of 1,000 Microsoft developers. And so this is how this visualization is going to look like. So each bubble corresponds to one developer, okay? And you see different activities, like you see email, you see planning activities, you see web browser, you see development activities in the bottom right. And the way we got this is basically by looking into what's the current application that people are working with. And then we mapped it to these categories. And what this visualization is going to show you as the day moves forward, like how people move between these different activities. Okay? And, okay, so wish me luck. Okay, so this is a visualization. So the top left shows you how late it is. And basically what it shows you is, so the not active is people who haven't started working yet. The not active anymore means when people have stopped working for the day. And what you see is that there's a lot of movement actually between email, web browsing, and development activities. So these are really the main three activities of software engineers. So there's one caveat in the web browser. You also have sometimes development tools are in the web browser. So if you go to Stack Overflow, that also technically should count as development, but it's hard to capture. But basically, it shows you people do a lot of different things. You see there's actually a fairly large amount of people inactive at a time. So they're not sitting in front of a computer. They're doing other things. It's lunchtime now, so more people are being inactive because we're taking lunch break. And as you slowly get into the afternoon, what you will see is that people start leaving work. So around 4 to 5-ish, people will stop working and yeah. So this visualization is actually inspired with a visualization like a typical day of American people, and it shows the same thing, just with like shopping, sleeping, eating, working, and things like that. So yeah, so this is just to give you an idea of it, like how different software development is for people. And also to give you an idea of how, like what types of data we can leverage to learn more about productivity. And so the way we collected this data is this visualization. So this was Windows developers. What the Windows developers do is they have special testing builds they use internally. So it's called dog fooding. And as part of these dog fooding builds is that basically is special telemetry collected, which has information which applications were being used. Okay. So what I want to talk to you about today is about, so when you think about productivity, if actually different perspectives that you can take. So a lot of people, when they talk about productivity, they think of productivity at the organization level or at the team level. Like how productive is like a manager's team? Can the manager do something to make his team more productive? What I want to talk to you about today is actually personal or individual productivity. So how can we learn more about the productivity of one developer and can we find ways of making them more productive? And you think in terms of sports team, if you have like a football team, like organization level would be the entire NFL, team level would be like the Seattle Seahawks, and individual productivity would be you want to focus on the quarterback or the running back or whichever team, whichever role you want. And it's also inspired by something called the personal software process by Watts Humphrey. And he actually came up with a lot of his ideas in, I think it was in the mid-80s. So basically 30 years ago. But the challenge 30 years ago was like a lot of the data collection you had to do manually. So basically people had to keep diaries of how they were working, things that didn't go well. And it just didn't take on because it was just so complicated to do. It's also inspired by fitness tracking devices. Like if you think of Apple Watch, Fitbit, Nike Bands, where people basically wear these devices and at the end of the day they can see how many steps they took, what the heart rate was, and they can use this information to become more healthy. And so somewhat like the long-term goal is, can we build like a personal productivity device, app, whatever, for software developers to become more productive. So what is productivity? So here's the Wikipedia page. It says productivity measure is expressed as the ratio of output to inputs used in a production process. So basically, it's output divided by input. There's been a large amount of research actually on productivity. But most of the research actually has been in the 80s and 90s, so there has not been too much work on productivity in recent years. So the landmark books are like Mythical Man Month, Soft Engineering Economics, Peopleware. These are like all very older type of books, but still very relevant books. People have proposed many different productivity measures. Remember, it's output divided by input. So basically, you can put in any type of measure for output, almost any measure for input, and you get your productivity measure. And all of these are valid in certain contexts, but there's not a single productivity measure which works for everything. So that's important to take away. So some people like to measure lines of code, but lines of code obviously is not accurate in all contexts. Because for some projects, like one line of code can be as efficient or as important as 100 lines of code in another project. People also looked into what influences productivity. So there are a lot of technical factors, like what product you're working on, if it's think of a complexity of a product. Is it like a user interface, which you're working on right now, versus is it like the Windows kernel, where things can go wrong very easily if you make a bad change. The process of your software team, the development environment, like what tools you're using, what practices you have for your software development, also what programming languages, if you have documentation or no documentation, how good is your documentation. All these influence productivity in some way. People also found that there are a lot of social factors. And that's actually something we also confirmed at Microsoft, is like the corporate culture makes a big difference for productivity. Team culture can have an impact. Capabilities and experiences, like how good is your team that you're working with? How much experience does it have? Your manager also impacts productivity. Like what work environment, like how close are you to your team? Are you distributed across different offices? Do you have open space offices or do you have your private offices? And also for team size. If you're in a big team, it might be more difficult to communicate than in a smaller team, and thus you're not as productive. So there are a lot of things which directly or sometimes indirectly impact productivity. So what we wanted to find out is when developers are productive. And we did various things for this. So I used observations. That's basically how it evolved over time. Initially, the research started off with observing developers. So that's where André Meyer, a student at University of Zurich, she was basically sitting behind software developers, was watching them writing software, and he was taking very detailed notes. He used this information then to build a monitoring tool, which basically could collect the same information in the background. And at some point, when we started working with the Windows team, we could get this same information through Windows telemetry for a larger set of people. So basically, the way of thinking is this: thinking of this is observation. So that was around 10 to 20 people. Monitoring tool, we had around 100 to 200 people using it. For Windows telemetry, we got data for 1,000 people at Microsoft. We also, like the monitoring tool that Andre built, it also collected productivity ratings. So that's basically a pop-up which comes every hour or two and asks you, how productive are you at the moment on a scale from 1 to 5? And also we did interviews and surveys. Yeah, so this is work with Andre. What I'm going to show you now is work with Andre Meyer. So he's the student working on this. And it's also joint work with Thomas Fritz at University of Zurich and Gail Murphy at UBC. And so what we started off is with a survey where we asked people when they have a productive workday. And so here you see some of the responses. I complete the goals that I set for myself that day. I get through a list of tasks for the day. So goals and tasks, that's what many people expect. So, and I'm going to show you actual responses here now. So some people, it comes down to writing code, how much code they can write. Sometimes even like one line of code is productive for them. If they can focus on certain activities, so if they don't have many interruptions or if they're not sidelined by meetings, then people also feel productive. If they have the autonomy to basically do what we want to do and don't have to wait for anyone else, we're not blocked by people. And there are lots of other things like the mood and sleep can influence your productivity. If the weather is good or not, or also like the work environment that you're sitting in. So if you summarize this, it's basically a lot of the comments were about task completion and goals. Interruptions and distractions was also very important in the responses that were mentioned. No meetings, clear goals, and people being able to plan for workday. So I want to show you this. I mentioned these observations. So it was around here the observations for 11 developers. And what you can see is each row corresponds to one developer. On the x-axis, you see the time in the session, in the observation session. The different symbols correspond to different activities. So if people were like spending like on development activities, if they were doing email, planning activities, reading or writing documents, things like that. And so, and if there's a line, it basically means that the activity was going on for a longer time. But what's really interesting is, if you look at this one here, you see, so subject S1, you see a lot of activity switches and task switches for this one person. So it was only like basically one period where they were had more time, and that was actually a planned meeting that we're working on. So you see people do switch a lot while working. But the surprising thing to us was that even though they switch a lot between different applications and different tasks, they still felt really productive. So when we found that they switched between 13.5 times per hour between different tasks, you would not expect them to be productive, but they felt productive. Yeah, so this is the tool that Andre built. It basically collects, like as I mentioned, it collects basically which applications that you're using. It collects some input activity, like how much typing you're doing, how much mouse movement. It also collects data about meetings, about emails, and also the self-reported productivity scores. And so here you can see a screenshot of what the tool also provides. Is once you keep running the tool for a while, you get like a dashboard which shows you what are the top programs that you use, how your productivity changes over time, some email statistics, and also where you spend your time, in what meetings, in what documents, and so on. So it's a bit similar to, I mean, a few people might know Rescue Time. So it has some features of Rescue Time, but also some additional features. And the reason we built this tool was to help us collect more data, but also to test out certain features with developers. So for example, one thing we could do is, once we had enough participants providing us with data, we searched for certain productivity patterns. And so here's a very simple pattern we found is, some people feel higher productivity in the afternoon, while some people feel not as productive during the lunch hours. We also used this to build productivity models. So basically, the idea was, for each session, we had a productivity score, like people felt very productive, not productive, and we had a set of features that we used to describe the session, and we used this to predict productivity. And so on the top left, you can see the productivity models. I don't want to go into details, but basically what we found is, so we built two types of model. So one explanatory model and one predictive model. So the explanatory model was to find out if we can describe for a large number of people what factors contribute to their own productivity. And so what we found is that for 20 participants, they all had different productivity models, and there was no single factor that we identified which had explanatory power for all participants. So what this tells you is, what makes you productive is probably very different from what makes me productive. There might be some people who have similar patterns, but it's like there's a lot of variety. Still, we found like the number of keystrokes and the number of mouse clicks, they often had more positive influence on productivity. And the percent of time in activities, email, planned meeting, work related browsing, and idle time, so idle time is time away from computer, they had often more negative influence. We also tried to predict productivity. So here the idea is, if you have a tool in the background which is monitoring your activity, can the tool tell if you're productive or not? So for example, if a tool recognizes you're super productive at the moment, then it might prevent you from any interruptions or distractions. If you're not so productive, it could do some intervention, like say, hey, go for a walk, or talk to this other developer who is not very productive at the moment. And so what we found is that, based on the data we collected, we could, even with a relatively small number of observations, we could predict productivity with precision and recall of around 70% for some participants. So it didn't work for everyone, but it worked for a fair amount of people. Okay, so one thing I try to bring across is that no two developers are the same. So we saw these different productivity patterns. Like some people more productive in the afternoon, not so productive during lunch. I showed you the different observations, so you could see there was a lot of variety, like they all somewhat look different. And also, when you think back to what people said about when they have productive work days, we got a huge variety of responses. So basically, we know that no two developers are the same, but the question is also if we can find developers who are very similar to each other. And basically, the idea is, can we narrow down the set of, say, hundreds of thousands of developers to like a small, distinct set of, say, 10 development personas, which we can use to build better tools. And so this is what I briefly want to talk about. The reason why this is useful is, once we know the different types of software developers, it helps us to, for empirical studies, to differentiate between the different types. because different types behave very differently, so it's something we need to account when we do empirical work. We can also build better tools which really tailor towards the different types of developers, and as a result, we can be more inclusive of the different types. So again, it's very similar technique as before we did with the data scientists. So we collected some data about software developers, and then we did some clustering to come up with different with developer productivity personas. And so the data that we used was, it was from a survey. We collected data for around 400 developers at Microsoft, and we asked them about their perceptions about productivity. So this clustering is based on self-reported data. I'm going to show you in a minute. So we basically collected data, we clustered, we got 6 clusters, and in the second step, we described the clusters based on our questions that we collected as part of the same survey. And so here are the different perceptions that we used. I feel more productive in the morning than in the afternoon. And basically, people could say if they strongly agree or strongly disagree with a statement. I feel more productive in the afternoon than in the morning. I feel productive on a day with little to no meetings. I feel productive when I do code review, when I write code, when I listen to music, quick break, for example, like on Facebook, checking up on friends, when I help my coworkers, and also when I read fewer emails than usual. And we had like 9 additional productivity perceptions. So here's what we found based on the clustering. Here are the 6 different clusters and how we described them. So the first one was kind of a social developer. So they actually felt productive when helping coworkers, when they were collaborating with others and doing code reviews. We also have the other side, like the lone developer. So they feel most productive when they have no disruptions, like no noise, no meetings. They don't like doing code review because they think it disrupts their work. And basically, they felt most just productive when they were not being interrupted. The focus developers, so they reported that they feel most productive when working on a single task. So they don't want to do too much multitasking. We found a group called, which we called the balanced developers. They actually weren't too much affected by disruptions, and they felt unproductive when they were working on tasks that they were not familiar with, or when the task description was not clearly described. Leading developers, so that's sort of a developer who's more likely in a management role. So they were much more comfortable with having meetings, and they placed less important actually on the coding activities than the other types of developers. And we also found something which we called goal-oriented developers. They felt really productive when they were making progress on tasks or when they were completing tasks. And also they felt less productive doing multitasking. So I want to wrap up this talk by briefly talking about a few opportunities for research. So I mentioned the PSP, the personal software process, and I think it's really first time for PSP to come back, and really now that we have so much data, we can be much more efficient with PSP-style techniques. Also, we can do a lot of, because there's a lot of data that is now available, we can, the way I think of it, it's like personal process mining. We can, the computer can learn about how developers are working, and then use this, once they've learned enough information, they can use this over time to make better recommendations. So really, like, one challenge is to describe people in a way that a computer can support them. And like a long-term vision is basically have some personal tutors who watch you programming in the back and help you improve your productivity. And that's it. So things I want to take you away from this talk is, for different types of data scientists, remember the top 10 questions of Microsoft, some of the things I showed you about observing developers, and there's no one stereotypical software developer. So thank you so much.